Okay. Test 1, 2, 3.
Good morning and welcome, everyone. Hopefully, as you took your seats, hopefully you saw a white sheet of paper located in the pews or on the seats. That will be our opening song, Warm the Time of Winter, which we've done the last few years here as our opening song to Advent and the liturgical year. We ask that when you depart, that you please leave these sheets of paper in your seats and the pews for the 11 a.m. congregation. So once again, that white sheet of paper is our opening song, Warm the Time of Winter, and we'll announce it again at the close of Mass that we ask that you please leave these sheets of paper at your seats and the pews for the 11 a.m. congregation. Thank you. Will the church please stand?
My dear brothers and sisters, today we begin the holy season of Advent. We open our hearts to God's love as we prepare to welcome Christ into our lives and our homes once more. The candles of this wreath remind us that Jesus came to conquer the darkness of sin and to lead us into the light of his glorious kingdom.
Brothers and sisters, listen to the words of the prophet Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Upon those who dwelt in the land of gloom, a light has shone. You have brought them abundant joy and great rejoicing. As they rejoice before you as at the harvest, as men make merry when dividing spoils. For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. Upon his shoulder dominion rests. They name him Wonder Counselor, God Hero, Father Forever, Prince of Peace. His dominion is vast and forever peaceful, from David's throne and over his kingdom, which he confirms and sustains by judgment and justice, both now and forever.
Lord our God, we praise you for your Son, Jesus Christ. He is Emmanuel, the hope of the peoples. He is the wisdom that teaches and guides us. He is the Savior of every nation. Lord God, let your peace and joy come upon us as we bless this wreath. May the wreath and its light be a sign of Christ's promise to bring us salvation. May he come quickly and not delay. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Of solitude, fill the silent icy night, may our hearts compassion. Holy light, warm our night, warm the time.
The Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, as we gather this morning, entering into this holy season of Advent, we take a moment to pause and reflect on those times that we've sinned so that we might prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Grant your faithful, we pray, Almighty God, the resolve to run forth to meet your Christ with righteous deeds at his coming. so that gathered at his right hand, they may be worthy to possess the heavenly kingdom. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. This is what Isaiah, son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest mountain and raised above the hills. All nations shall stream toward it. Many peoples shall come and say, "Come, let us climb the Lord's mountain to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may instruct us in his ways and we may walk in his paths. For from Zion shall go forth instruction and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations and impose terms upon many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. One nation shall not raise the sword against another, nor shall they train for war again. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Set
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, you know the time. It is the hour now for you to awake from sleep. For our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is advanced. The day is at hand. Let us then throw off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us conduct ourselves properly as in the day. Let an orderliness and drunkenness, let an promiscuities and lust, let an rivalry and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provisions for the desires of the flesh. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Blessing, Father. Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. In those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day that Noah entered the ark. They did not know until the flood came and carried them all away. So will it also be at the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be out in the field. One will be taken, and one will be left. Two women will be grinding at the mill. One will be taken, and one will be left. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know on which day your Lord will come. Be sure of this. If the master of the house had known the hour of night when the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and not let his house be broken into. So too, you also must be prepared, for at an hour you do not expect, the Son of Man will come." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So this is Thanksgiving weekend. I hope yours has been great so far. It's also the first Sunday of Advent, the first day of the liturgical year. So Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Now, I mentioned, this is going to be one of those homilies you like or you hate. So I mentioned before how I love connections. Connections that are neat in themselves, but sometimes are also analogies that help us to understand something entirely different. So I'd like to tell you about three things. I guess you'd call them events. Three things that are neat in themselves, but also connected, that happened this week to me. So bear with me a bit. I'll try to make the connections clear at the end. The first involves Sherlock Holmes. I've been rereading some Sherlock Holmes stories, and it's from a volume that's annotated. I picked one up a long time ago at one of the book sales at the Lowell Library. I came home and lamented to Laura that it was only one out of a two-volume set, so she went back the next day and rummaged through stacks of books and found the second one, so thank you. The annotations are interesting. This story happens to be the crooked man, and at the end of it, Holmes makes a biblical reference. And one of the annotations says that a number of Sherlock scholars suggest that Holmes was Catholic. And I think that makes a lot of sense, because what does Holmes do? He uses deduction, he uses logic, he uses reasoning to carefully observe and then to discover the truth. At the same time, in some of the stories about him, he remarks about the beauty and the wonder that he sees in the world around him. One of the encyclicals that John Paul II wrote was Fides et Ratio, Faith and Reason, in which he explained that our Catholic faith is built on faith, but it is strengthened by reason. The two of them work hand in hand together. We see beauty, but we also reason about the world that we see, about the God that loves us. Pope Benedict, mainly as Cardinal Ratzinger, wrote about the Logos, the Word. In John's prologue, in the Gospel of John's prologue, he says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." That word in the Greek is logos, word, and it means the person of Jesus Christ. But that word is also has a lot more meaning to it, because in some circumstances it can mean rational thought, examination to discover the truth. It can mean that which creates and sustains and holds everything together. Logos can be the word that is spoken by Christ's disciples under the inspiration of the Spirit. And I thought that was kind of neat, that Holmes, that Sherlockian connection to the way that we experience our faith. The second thing was that a couple days ago I came across an article in the New York Times by Tish Harrison Warren. Now, she's an Anglican priest, but I'd call her a high Anglican. Her theology and her social awareness is pretty much aligned with Catholic teaching. And this article was called "Even Your Political Enemies Deserve a Slice of Pie." And she said, at this time of Thanksgiving, we ought to do a couple of things. We ought to celebrate an Interdependence Day, not an Independence Day, an Interdependence Day, because too often we think that our accomplishments are due solely to our own hard work and to our own cleverness. But in reality, they never are. They're always intertwined with our interactions with other people. And she suggests some ways to celebrate this interdependence, to develop a deeper sense of gratitude, to focus on all of the unseen people, to honor your political enemies, to recognize our dependence on the earth, and to become more neighborly. She also calls on us to use the daily examine, a reflection on the day, what you might call an examination of conscience, to increase our ability to notice, to be aware. Now, I was disappointed that she just called it an ancient Christian tradition. She didn't point out of the really great Ignatian connection, but that doesn't really diminish from what she says, because she writes that in the examine, one takes intentional time, often in the evening, to look back and notice places of sorrow, pain, failure, or a sense of God's absence, and lift those moments to God. Then one notices those moments of joy, provision, goodness, and a sense of God's nearness in the day, and gives thanks. This daily way of reviewing a day slowly teaches me to recognize, even on the very worst days, those small gifts of grace that carried me. When we have our instructions, especially to parents, on preparing our kids for the sacraments, we talk about how important it is to use daily prayer, even in young kids, and that daily examine can be a great way to do that. So I thought that was kind of neat. The third event I'd like to mention, is our Thanksgiving dinner, the one that we just had. And I got to tell you, it was great. This was a good year for Thanksgiving dinner. Gina and Joe made ducks and Cornish hens. The kids liked the little bitty turkeys, the Cornish hens. And that was kind of neat. And Gina made squash and potatoes and dressing and more. And Laura made bean casserole and cranberry relish, cream cheese and pineapple dip. And Vicky, her signature pumpkin pancakes, brownies and cookies. And Jim kind of tied everything together because he gave everybody a card that expressed the feelings of Thanksgiving. It was really good. Now, I got to tell you, when we get together for things like this, besides the big meal, we also precede them with appetizers. I don't know if anybody else does that or not, but we have a table filled with appetizers. Anybody else like smoked oysters? No? Oh, man, I love them. How about pickled herring? Anybody like pickled? Yes, see, there's a couple. Well, besides that, we also had cold shrimp and tangy cocktail sauce, and Gina provided cheese and a great selection of olives and some wonderfully sweet heirloom tomatoes. We rolled up some little salami for the, because the kids like it, and I like to take them and pass them to the dog under the table. The timing was perfect. And we ate, and it was just great. We finished playing games and watching a movie. But it isn't always like this. It always hasn't been like this. And most of the time, it's been my fault. I'm supposed to get the ham ready, and I miscalculate, and the ham is ready an hour and a half after I said it would be. Or on some of the weekends when I was working, I said, don't worry, I'll leave early. And then something comes up. And instead of being home at 3 o'clock, it's 4 o'clock or 5 o'clock or 8 o'clock at night. The temptation when that happens is to say, well, I have another plate of appetizers. It's going to be a while. I have another plate of appetizers. And then, it's still not ready. I have another plate of appetizers. And that can go on for a while. And pretty soon, we've filled ourselves up with so much appetizers that we can't appreciate the big meal. We can't appreciate the main meal because we're too full. And that caused me to think a little bit. Each of these events was interesting for me and a cause of reflection for me, but I think they're also connected. They're connected to Advent. Paul tells us to treat one another better, and that's part of what Advent is. In the gospel, Jesus tells us to look at the time because we don't know the time. We don't know when Christ is coming, and so always be prepared. At Advent, we're called to recognize Christ as the Word, but to also recognize our place in creation and ultimately our goal of eternity into heaven. We're called to use both our faith and reason to grow closer to God. We're called to develop a sense of gratitude and to recognize our interconnectedness with those around us. We're called to develop at Advent our prayer life, but not just for Advent, but to learn a change, a growth, a deepening of our prayer life for all of our life. To recognize that sometimes we try to fill a hunger with things that don't totally satisfy, that keep us from attaining, enjoying the main course. Advent's a time to put those aside, to recognize that sometimes a little hunger is good because when we eventually satisfy what we're looking for, it tastes that much sweeter. I'd like to close with the alternate prayer from the Liturgy of the Hours morning prayer for today. Father in heaven, our hearts desire the warmth of your love, and our minds are searching for the light of your word. Increase our longing for Christ our Savior, and give us the strength to grow in love, that the dawn of his coming may find us rejoicing in his presence and welcoming the light of his truth. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Lord. Amen. Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again
in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As we enter this season of preparation and joyful anticipation, we lift up our petitions to our God and Father.
We are reminded by Jesus in today's gospel that we should always be awake, for we never know when our loving Father will call us to him. We pray, Lord, that in our busy lives, we always remain alert and be prepared to listen to your voice and carry out your will. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Today is the first Sunday of Advent, reminding us that the preparation should begin for Christmas. We pray that our preparation be a spiritual one and that our real joy be in celebrating the coming of Christ our Savior. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, during Advent, in hope and confidence, we pray that you grant us the wisdom, time, and foresight to review how each live our lives with our family, our friends, our community, our work, and most importantly, with our God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray that we who are safe from the horrors of war open up our hearts to the refugees who seek safety among us and support those who strive to give them shelter and peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
As we come to the end of November, when we especially remember our dead brothers and sisters, we pray that the Lord be merciful to all our departed, and may he bring healing and consolation to their grieving loved ones. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Father Frank Torres, whose funeral was Monday, may he rest in the peace of our Lord. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for George Kmetz, whom we remember in a special way at this liturgy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Merciful and loving Father, hear the prayers your children offer to you this day and answer them according to your will. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Our preparation song is number 68, Creator of the Stars of Night, number 68.
Everlasting.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your name, for the good and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Accept, we pray, O Lord, these offerings we make gathered from among your gifts to us, and may what you grant us to celebrate devoutly here below gain for us the prize of eternal redemption. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he assumed at his first coming the lowliness of human flesh, and so fulfilled the design you formed long ago, and open for us the way to eternal salvation, that when he comes again in glory and majesty, and all is at last made manifest, we who watch for that day may inherit the great promise in which now we dare to hope. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world. For by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Edward, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Robert our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Our communion song will be number 48, Beyond the Moon and Stars, number 48.
See you.
chose to dwell with us in flesh and bone. Beyond the moon and stars, as deep as night, so great our hunger, Lord, to see your light.
Michael, the archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and the other evil spirits who prowl about the world for the ruin of souls. Amen. And our vocation prayer, God, our Father, you made each of us to use our gifts in the body of Christ. We ask that you inspire young people whom you call to priesthood and consecrated life to courageously follow your will. Send workers into your great harvest so that the gospel is preached, the poor are served with love, the suffering are comforted, and your people are strengthened by the sacraments. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And in regard to that vocation prayer, I would ask you to keep Bishop McClory in your prayers as he and his closest, what would you call them, consultors, are going to be discussing what happens now with our Spanish Mass. We do need a priest who can hear confessions in Spanish and celebrate the Mass in Spanish. That's going to be me for right now, but I can do neither of those things. Father Tom Mishler, who you remember from St. Edward some years ago, also needs help at St. Helens and at St. Mary's in Coutts. So every time, sadly, that a priest dies or retires, there's one less card in the deck for the bishop to be able to shuffle and move around. So We pray for vocations and pray for our bishop as he faces the challenges that are put before him. Let us pray. May these mysteries, O Lord, in which we have participated, profit us, we pray, for even now as we walk amid passing things, you teach us by them to love the things of heaven and to hold fast to what endures. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Some announcements this morning. In the vestibule, the Daughters of Isabella are selling raffle tickets, a fundraiser, their baskets of cheer after all masses. Please don't forget to pick up your angel tree tag. If you could pick up a couple, that would be great. There are still some along the back with the little buckets and pens for writing what you need to write. And there are trees also still in the front. Please be as generous as you can as we help the increasing number of those in our community who need little assistance to ensure a happy Christmas. Also, very importantly, if you are on the parish pastoral council or finance council, we have a meeting Thursday at 7 p.m. We will meet, we'll cram in there, but we'll meet in the back conference room in the office, so you can park in the back and come on in Thursday at 7, probably one of the more important council meetings we'll have during my time here. So if you can at all come, please do so. Also, this is the last opportunity for ordering Scrip gift cards for Christmas. Orders are due next weekend. Please also remember we have the little blue books for the daily Advent reflections for you in the vestibule. There's English regular size, English large print edition, and also some editions in Spanish for our Spanish speakers and Spanish readers. Also, if this is part of your Christmas tradition, we do have a Płatki available in the sacristy. I think it's $2 for an envelope. Just if you want one envelope, I think there's, what, three pieces or something like that in there. I don't even remember. But just take one out and just kind of put the money in the bottom of that same little box, okay? Okay. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
And just a friendly reminder to please leave the white sheets of paper with warm the time of winter on them in your seats and pews for the 11 a.m. Mass. Thank you.
Our closing hymn is number 407. To you, O God, I lift up my soul. Number 407.
To you, O God, I lift up my soul. My soul, lift up my spirit.
Please take your bulletins home with you. Please do not leave anything in the pews except the white sheets of paper with warm the time of winter. Thank you.